Welcome all. I hope you join the next time and you keep coming, you keep contributing. So consider this forum as collaborating and discussing ideas and growing the community. Okay, so once again, good morning and welcome to it. Welcome to you all. I'm handing over the mic to Diego. He will start with the actual presentation now. Thank you.
So hi everyone. I'm Diego. It is a pleasure to welcome you all to this year's conference. We have gathered here today to exchange ideas, share knowledge, engage in meaningful discussions on many topics. We are very honored to have some of the most experienced users, implementers, and developers here today to share their insights and help us better understand the challenges and opportunities ahead. Our goal is to foster an environment of collaboration, innovation, and community to help us create a brighter future for the project. So thank you all for being here. Small reminder, we'll have a coffee break at 10. Then a lunch break at 1, and the last coffee break at 4. So the snacks and coffee are on the right side. You don't tell me what the conference is. To all the keynote speakers, please respect the time that was given to you so we can all just have our opportunity to talk. And I will be taking pictures and we will record. Please, if anyone has any issue with being photographed or anything, please let me know and I will make sure to not publish anything. Besides that, we wish you all a great conference experience, enjoyable and like his hospitality and effort has been amazing. So thank you. I think that's it. Let's start with the first presentation that will be put on by Carlos Ruiz. He will show us what's new since the last conference. So have a nice call. Have you enjoy.
Hello. Happy to be here. Thanks a lot to Dora. We do this every conference. Normally we start with this kind of, this is not a formal presentation, the slides that I usually just mention what has happened this years and show some of the stuff. This, in these 4 years, a lot of things have happened, so I cannot show everything. I will focus on maybe the most prominent. And if you want to ask me or want me to show something, just tell me and I will try to do it by this time. And yeah, there was the first iDempiere conference was in Krefeld by Thomas 2013. And there we made what is new on iDempiere since iDempiere. And then we in 2015 again in Krefeld. So we made the same gap 2 years. And in Lyon we made it in 2019. 4 years, that was a lot of work. And this time is again 4 years. So it's a lot of new things there.
The time we did this exercise was October 31, Halloween of 2019. And we have released 4 versions. Normally the schedule of iDempiere is we release 1 version every year, so that matches 7.1, 8.2, 9, and 10. that is 1,190 days. And we have, I made the counts, we have made 1,833 commits in these days. And the commits are from 44 committers, different committers. 1,191 tickets, one per day. That's impressive. So, a lot of. And there are so many things that we have worked on, yeah? This time I organized the things a bit. There are so many things that it was not easy how to organize. So I did this. We worked on security. We implemented multi-factor authentication. Yeah, the thing that multi-factor authentication, we made it pluggable. And by default in iDempiere, we implemented two authentication. One is TOTP, the common Google Authenticator stuff in your phone, and also via email, you can do two-factor authentication, yeah? This was, I think this is very important. Normally people say that the passwords are not enough to protect any system. And the next layer of protection is two-factor authentication, yeah? The other thing that we did, I think you remember that in former times, the password was unencrypted in a properties file, yeah? So everybody can open a properties file and read the password, the database password, all the passwords were there, yeah? So we changed that, and now the passwords are safer, encrypted, but it's also like kind of configurable that you can even save the passwords in an external provider and just don't have the password in your server. But by default, it doesn't work like that. Yeah, the password is still on the server, kind of obfuscated. It's not encrypted, yeah, it's obfuscated. But you can externalize that. That's possible, yeah? And another thing that we did was this specified tenant on login. So when we enter here, super user system, yeah? Normally we enter like this. But here, if we change this login tenant with prefix, then I can, the values are no or allow or false. So let's say allow. And this is the prefix separator in login. Okay. So when we use this, you can specify here the tenant, like this. Oh, shoot. Yes? Oh, force warning. Ah, yes, yes, yes. This will not work because it says before setting you must fill the tenant prefix. So we added this here, login prefix, to identify the tenants in that, for example, system. Yeah. And garden wall. Yes. say that number. Tenant. And I say, this is my prefix, G. Okay. And now, for example, if I want to go to Garden World, I can go directly. If I want to go to System, I can go directly here. Yeah. This was intended for security to allow to have the tenant defined on login and not in the second page where user can choose several tenants. And it's for integration with external systems mostly. In security, we don't have it yet. Deepak is going to show it later, I think. Deepak is working on single sign-on. I think that's another big things that is going to happen in security very soon. Yeah. And Deepak is doing that
in a very nice way to enable interfaces so we can make external authorizations.
Hello, hello, hello.
Okay, hello. Ready? Okay, okay. Okay, some things we did with the architecture. Well, we have normally we are very up to date with libraries, with the Java versions, Postgres version, Oracle versions. We try to keep very close to the last version. Normally we don't use the last, but probably the previous one. But Hensing normally keeps this running very close to not get obsolete. And in the 9th version, we made the Postgres native, yeah? Before release 9, all iDempiere run like in Oracle, and there was a conversion layer that converted all SQL statements to Postgres, and then hit the database. Yeah, and in release 9 we made Postgres. So we removed the conversion layer. Is what happened. Yeah.
But now when the iDempiere hits Oracle, talks Oracle, and when it hits Postgres, talks Postgres. There is no conversion.
And another big thing we did in release 10 was we had a, before it was 3.3.0. We have a connection pool library. Yeah. That was C3P0, C3PO, and it was replaced by Hitari CP. The thing is transparent for end users like that, but it's a big change in terms of what the library says is less memory, consumes less memory, and is faster. Yeah? So, we expect that. In terms of mail, we added support for OAuth 2 because Google, Microsoft, all of these providers were deprecating password authentication in mail. So we needed to implement OAuth 2. I mean, that's already there. All of these that I am showing you, we have a wiki, and the wiki has a category that says new features. Yeah. So every thing that I am talking to you have a documentation here. Yeah.
For example, this is 8.2, and it's 0 out of 2. Here. And here is explained how it was implemented and how to configure, etc. Yeah. Every new feature has a explanation. Yeah. And Nicolas added this also. Before release 9, we had one SMTP server per tenant, and now Nicolas added that a tenant can have multiple mail providers. Yeah. That's very important. In reporting, we added, this is very nice. Two things were added in reporting print formats. For example, here we can issue a report, and when you go here in format meeting, you have two new things: the display logic that works similar, the same as display logic in Windows. Yeah? So you say, I want this field to be shown when another field has this value. It's very useful. And the other is a script. We have to add this type here, script. Yeah? And with the scripting, we can do formulas here. Here you write a script. You can write formulas, multiply a column by another column, and stuff like that. And even I think you can do SQL and get information from other tables or calculations. Of course, performance can be affected if you do strange things. But it's very, it gives another level to the reporting. In terms of, I say like we do things that helps the designer designing Windows, or helps things that help users, things that help developers, etc. Yeah. So for the UI design, we have these multi-select fields. In 7.1, we did this. This kind of fields, transactions, for example. Yeah. This field, product category, for example. Yeah. You can choose several product categories. And the report will show these multiple categories. Yeah. Before 7.1, we didn't have this kind of multi-selection fields. So it's very useful. And it works directly with reports and with the info windows. It's straight. Yeah. It works. For example, in the info window, we have media management. Here, the same, you can have multiple status dual style. And in Windows, you can add this kind of multi-selection fields in Windows, but there is a trade-off there, yeah? When you save a multi-selection field in the database, it's saved as a string of IDs separated by commas or semicolons, commas, yeah. And it doesn't have any foreign key validation. So it's kind of dangerous. It's very useful, but it doesn't have foreign key
checks in the database. So
use it with care. Quick form was added by GitHub. Sex order, for example. This one. Yeah. It's a new way to entry things just using the keyboard. Yeah. You can enter sales order lines without the mouse. That's the goal of quick form. Yeah. You define which field to use, and you can just use the keyboard to enter things. As a layer. And for example, if I say two, and when I arrive to the last one, down, that's a new line for enter. So it's very for like this. Functionality says it's a quick form because normally people is faster with the keyboard than with the mouse. So. We have also radio buttons as a new UI element. What do we have this? It's just another way to show lists. Yeah? Right here, client, role, user. Yeah? This element here is a radio button, yeah? But it's just another way to show lists. And Nicolas added wizard for the multiple selection. This is multiple selection editor, but it's not visible here, but in Windows you can have a wizard and it shows two lists of items and you can order them and move them from left to right or vice versa. In Murillo's team added this here too. That makes the opposite, yeah? So if I issue this report, it will show me the categories computers, raw materials, and tools. And if you do this, it shows me all except this three, yeah? So it's negating the selection. There's all of these new tools, yeah? Okay. Things that make users happy. For example, all the attachments, when you are here and you have attachments, the users can download all the attachments at once. Yeah. The users can now also have a query saved. This kind of queries here, that we can configure queries and save them. And users can now also share queries, yeah? With the rest of the system. The toolbar was also totally redesigned. It was mostly following advice from Norbert. We put the select query here and the most common buttons in the toolbar here. And then there is a more that shows the rest of buttons. Before it was too crowded, the toolbar was. And now we made it shorter and the more button shows the rest. And the good thing is totally configurable. So you can, if in your implementation you use a lot export button, you can move it to the main part of the toolbar. it's just configuration. Grid toggle button here. You can have now this, yeah, to see the detailing master list that was added to let users work easier. Find window with extended controls. Ah, yes, this is another that we can define which fields to show here. And if the users can have access to advanced or not. And another big thing that was in recent version was that we can now search records by conditions on the detail tabs. Yeah. So I can search orders that have these products. We could not do that before. The print format editor too. What else is desktop favorite dashboard was revamped by IPA. Yeah. This favorites here was very plain and now IPA added folders, automatic launch control. And the folders can be automatically open or closed, yeah, when the user enters. It's very useful now and more clear. In info window, you can, here for example, you have these new buttons in info windows. This select all and deselect all. This is when the info windows have 1,000 records to process, for example, and the user needed to come page by page selecting 50 records each time. Now the user can just push here and select the 1,000 records to process something. Yeah. In the opposite, the select. Field groups in process parameters, record info, this is here to simple buttons to copy thermalink. And this is handy for us, yeah. When I say copy select, it puts in the clipboard. Yes. So I go to my deliver and it's immediate. Save documents to attachments. Before we create a report and we can archive the report and it goes to a table that we name is named archive. But now there is another button to set to saving attachments. Like, yeah? The report can be go to attachment. And hence it added a file preview for Excel. So when you issue a report in Excel format, you can preview it here, like. And also, okay, the file name of the orders and invoices and all of that is configurable now. Or this is deeper, yeah. Dash files using drag and drop. And hence, indeed, also this about auto-saving changes. This is a way of work that in test we have it enabled. And you are changing the record and it's being saved. You don't need to push the save button. Yeah. And these are changes that make life easier for developers. A lot of changes, yeah. Even the status line. Creating a new window now is very, very fast, yeah. It becomes we have now a create table process, yeah, yeah. So I can do, let's create this table, and the access level is this, and it says You want to create a key column, you want to create a workflow, a translation table, value, name, description, etc. Yeah? If you want document number, doc accent, doc status, process, and blah, blah, blah. Yeah. For example, when you say, I want to create a workflow, when you wanted a workflow, most of the time you forget that the workflow needs document action, document status, process, yeah, all of this. But this process now is that, and when you say create workflow, immediately enable the columns that you need. Yeah. Same with the translation table. Normally we created the translation table and forgot to add some link, parent link and things like that. And this process creates it like we need. And let's say I create this table here. And there is another process here that says, create a window for this table, yeah? So I said, okay, I want a window for this table and create the menu also. Ready? And I have now here, I need to go to the table and create it in the table. Synchronize. Okay. And now we have the window working. Yeah. So it's very fast now to create a table, create a window, and it just works. And then I fine tune this. Inject context from context variables from menu. Operating system variables in context. All of these are tools that we use as developers to make it easier. We also tried that all the operations in the database can be done from the interface. So I can come here and drop the table or rename the table in the database. Yeah. So many operations that we needed to go to SQL and do drop table, rename table, etc., can be done now from iDempiere. I think the only thing that we cannot do now on iDempiere is create functions, triggers, that functions and triggers. But we can create views, foreign keys, indexes, everything within iDempiere. Yeah.
On the Word document.
Yeah.
The operating system variable.
Yes. Yes.
Can you elaborate on that?
Operating system variable is simple. You have the context here. And you have the display logic, for example, or mandatory logic. And you can say, I think it's something like this. And put the user equals Alex, for example. Yeah? This means the environment variable from the operating system.
So if I do an export, so if I have a production system, I do an export on a variable. I think there are people reading that server's environment variable.
Yes, that's the idea, because that's why this is done, because when you create multiple servers sometimes for load balancing, sometimes you want to identify which server I am running. So you create a variable in context, in script, in operating system, to identify the server, and then you can use it in context. I am not sure if this is the syntax that is in Wiki. There are a lot of new ways to define the
Yeah, we have many ways, by the way. But we can define callouts within a factory, and now we can define a lot using just annotations. So Henson created a new, many new ways to define the callouts, documents, even handlers, etc. Yeah.
Is it okay to ask questions?
Yes, yes.
So is there a default? Is there if, for example, the annotations is the newest way, is it safe to assume that if an annotation method exists, that is the preferred way? Is that safe to assume?
We are not dropping the old way. We are still using all those ways. Yes.
Okay. So there's not a preferred way. It's just a preference.
Yeah, but I think it's also like more modern ways. Yeah, annotations are like the latest, more common way to do it. Yeah, and the first way that we did with plugin.xml, that is very obsolete and almost nobody uses that, but it's still working. But we don't recommend. Yeah. This is also for very important for developers is we added all the customization layer on tenants, yeah. So we have window customization that we have the window and we can fine-tune the window for a tenant, but also info windows and also process. So we can change the behavior of window, info windows, and processes for every tenant, user, role, and language. I think there are four levels. You can change that depending on, yeah. So that is very, that solves a lot of times when you have multiple tenants and one tenant asks for a small change, but just they want that. We do it this way. It's very interesting. And also, I find it very useful because you isolate the changes from the dictionary. So it doesn't, the migration to new version doesn't affect your customizations. Yeah. It's isolated. Lightweight theme. Is that we implemented a way to change things in the default thing without making a new thing. Yeah, making a new thing is big and we need 1,000 images and all the CSS files. Yeah, but we implemented a way that if we want the default thing but just change one value, it's possible to inject that. Workflows, there were some changes in workflows. Messages at tenant level too. SQL workflow condition that was there but didn't work and now is implemented. Okay. For the DevOps, we are over time now, but I will just mention this. For the DevOps, the administrator of servers, we have also some tools like this, storage provider. When we have the attachments in Amazon S3 and then we want to change it to, I don't know, Dropbox or whatever, there is a process that migrates all the attachments and can do it, not all at once, can do it in several steps. Roll scripts within a Tupac, yeah? Tupac is becoming too powerful now. And you can write Tupac. Tupac always have been able to run SQL statements, yeah? But now Tupac is also able to run shell scripts and to run bin shell scripts in a Tupac. SQL query and SQL process is that we implemented here.
two windows, SQL query and SQL process. Here you can issue queries, and SQL process you can execute, update, insert, alter, whatever. Yep. Just sometimes you need to do things and you don't have access to the database, direct access, you can do that. Ah, this is very interesting. Virtual columns are always, have always been like very useful thing, but very forbidden. Yeah. For years I have said, please don't use that or use it very carefully because the performance is heavily affected, the virtual columns. But now somebody implemented that the virtual columns are not loaded by default, just when you need it. And that made the old advice obsolete. Yeah, now you can use that. Also, recently I implemented a migrate helper. When we apply migration scripts, sometimes the migration script destroys things that I customized. Yeah. So this is a process that you migrate and run, migrate first in a test environment and run this process. And the process shows you customizations that you made that are different now in the database. Yeah. So if I change the size of a column and the migration changes it back, it shows me that. Attach size per table. Okay. Functional, about functional, we have some interesting things. Products not on price list can be shown and can be used. First we show it and then we allow it to use it. Period control management for accounting. Reverse sign in financial report. Steven is going to show us later. But multiple formulas for manufacturing and auto produce. And for usability, we have done also a lot of things, mostly guided by Norbert. And I think that's the next presentation, so I will let Norbert talk about that. Okay? That's all.
Question for you.
We're out of time, yeah? It was 45 minutes?
Okay. Yeah, a question.
Yes?
On the database side, you are mentioning that password authentication and the SSO, single sign-on, and creating the DB object from the iDempiere software side. So when Postgres, any of Postgres databases comes with all those features, do we really necessary to redo that work in the ERP end?
Yeah, we use the database for us is just to save records. We don't use really the database capabilities of, yeah, because we support Postgres and Oracle. And theoretically, we can support any database. Yeah, there is a port for MySQL. I have done work, for example, implementing in Sybase and SQL Server. So we try to be agnostic about databases. We try to not use specific things from databases to keep that layer apart from
it. While retrieving when the ERP systems grow and we're retrieving the data, so if anyhow it used to talk to the database, right? So data is in the end, data is residing in the database, uh-huh. The backend. So while retrieving the data from the application side, you always need to do the database help is needed, always be needed to retrieve the data.
Mm-hmm.
From the application side. So it makes sense, always you should take the capabilities of PostgreSQL database.
You mean, for example, Oracle's single sign-on or things like that? Or
PostgreSQL. Postgres.
Postgres, yeah.
Yeah.
Which capability of Postgres, for example?
So, in the end, right now we are trying to recreate the SQL and the DB objects from the iDempiere side. Right? We are taking the very less advantage of the database, where the database is getting used to store only the data. But in future, when the data grows, so large amount of data needs to capture from the Postgres itself. So then these queries, rebuilding these queries on the identical size may make a bottleneck going forward. So it always makes sense, because PostgreSQL has become the very advanced OLTP database now. So it already have the database features, right? So maybe I might be wrong, but I would recommend that. But we need to take the advantage of already existing open source database PostgreSQL, so that we can more focus on the identical software, ERP software. So that right now, 20 to 30% of work we can avoid that, right? Single sign-on. So we are already implementing with various customers single sign-on with LDAP authentication, right? The password authentication, all of this stuff already exists with the PostgreSQL. So that piece we can avoid from the identity side. Rather, we should focus on the development side, ERP, functional point of view side, developer side, DevOps side, right? So database is anyhow we are going to use as a backend database, PostgreSQL. So that's my only one suggestion.
The way that Deepak is doing single sign-on is to make it pluggable, yeah? So we can use different ways to do it, yeah? So if there is a database that provides that, we can connect it.
Yes.
That's
so PostgreSQL is coming with all the advanced features now. Mm-hmm. It can have MD5, it can have PAM, Kerberos, LDAP authentication, single sign, all the features are already there, right? We just need to plug, anyway, it is a Java-based application. So when it is talking to the database, automatically all your users will in the end will get created in the database itself. Right? So while littering, authentication is happening, so it will come up with the successful authentication only. After authentication only, application connection will be established.
Yeah. Yeah, but we are not doing the single sign-on, yeah?
Yeah.
We are just enabling other authenticators to be connected, to be the authenticator for iDempiere. Yeah? So if Postgres has a single sign-on implementation, we could use it.
Yes.
Yeah, it's just another plugin for Postgres. Yeah, that's the way like we tend to think these things, is like make them pluggable.
Yes. I think one more recommendation I would like to do in this conference is, I have seen on the website that we are supporting PostgreSQL as well as Oracle, right? But now I have seen the trend that people are moving away from Oracle because of the licensing cost. So I think we should more focus on the PostgreSQL itself for our ERP open source. When we are ERP, we are promoting as open source ERP, right? We should only plug only open source databases in the backend rather than the proprietary databases. So that's one of my suggestions. So customer will raise the question, okay, when I'm moving away from ERP proprietary to open ERP, your iDempiere, then why you are suggesting Oracle? Yeah. I need to incur huge licensing cost.
The thing is that many, when we go to companies, many companies just have the policy established there and they just use, for example, many companies use just Oracle, yeah? And they will not do Postgres. Mostly the big companies have this kind of policies. Yeah, we have lost business, for example, because there are companies that just use Microsoft products. Yeah, so they just use SQL Server.
Yeah,
and we don't have a SQL Server port. And they say no way.
No, but when we are talking about the SAP.
For us, it's important to keep at least these two. Yeah, Postgres and Oracle.
Yes.
We would like to have more, yeah, SQL Server and MySQL, but at least we try to keep this two, yeah, Oracle and Postgres. Oracle is normal for very big companies, they just use
Oracle. And you will not have the entire system on one iDempiere. iDempiere could be just one plugin over some module. They may be still be deciding to continue, let's say, Oracle ERP. Or any other ERP on some third party software. That's the finance model. iDempiere will just be a plugin on some one functionality. People now use desktop grid, right? They may be using an Oracle finance ERP. Well, let's say 15 years and they are not interested in that's a movie. But they just want to add, let's say, a small module on iDempiere or let's say,
yeah,
HRM. So you can easily plug in if it is not a clear. I think we should be more open for all databases. I didn't know that you were supporting Sybase actually. Or you're moving towards, you know, seeing whether Sybase can be or let's say Microsoft.
It's possible, but to maintain that it has.
Yeah, exactly. So,
The problem is not doing the first, but maintaining
it. It's not always.
I don't submit like for all the data is going for the use for the but not for because the every contribution for supporting all the data is cost high.
That is.
We have to test with every data and it's not possible.
No, I'm not saying all databases, but what I'm saying is at least see the point is that. Are you asking the customer to throw away his existing investments?
No, iDempiere do not. iDempiere do not. Correct. So that's why we have the database is a completely separate layer. So if someone wants to cyber, MySQL, or whatever, they can write their own layer. It's like a few class, one class maybe. Okay, and take care about the conversion of queries. It's done. But do you know the SAP is having the challenges because of the database? Because the SAP user licenses are getting increased and the customers are really fed up because of the user license. Where their user license is getting filled up because of the database license. They are putting the Oracle and the SQL Server as a backend and they say we don't want to pay this 50,000
so
for user license.
Correct.
Postgres
SQL and Oracle.
Yes,
supporting
and Oracle because we are supporting Oracle generally, correct? And still some of the implementation are still in Oracle. So whenever we are enhancing, we have to look into backward compatibility. Okay, and like more of the existing users, right? We can't just drop the Oracle support for because every time, correct? Each and every database support we are adding in a core. Is posting on every contribution for SP. So it's cannot possible like we can support multiple, but whatever you have like two, one is Oracle, which is known for like a large data and Postgres SQL. Now we know that Postgres SQL is doing good, but still from DBA standpoint, Oracle is better.
No, see, I'm not denying this is not a debate for the Oracle is better or Postgres. See, right now, iDempiere has a motto to promote the open source ERP, right?
Yeah. The thing from my point of view is that we do ERP is for companies, and the companies define the database that they use. We sometimes we cannot say use Postgres. Some companies simply reject anything that is not their database. So if we say we just use Postgres, we are closing some doors, and usually those are big doors. We don't want that. Yeah, this is more like that because this is for business.
Right.
the ERP. Yeah. Is SAP? I think SAP before I remember SAP always said that the database was a commodity, and they said they were very agnostic and they run in any database. And they, for years, they said you don't write a trigger in database, yeah? And some years ago, SAP released HANADB. So it's SAP database, and they changed all the speech. And now they say that you must write everything in the database, but in their database. So I think it's business. It's not the database agnostic, just that it's their database now and they are interested in some vendor locking there.
It's also a reason behind the gap. And it's because we have the power in the organization.
Mm.
So you don't want to take that responsibility as a DSA implement. You want to give the power to the VDA. So they can do whatever they want. They want to do advanced stuff, they want to do, okay, we can use it, that's good. We have a massive command of vector is the limit the power of the GA. Yeah, I guess that this is a more decoupled layer in the database. Mm-hmm. And in terms of performance, we are delegating that, for example, to the DevOps of the company, yeah, which is a good practice.
Yeah. And that grows, and they need to tune it, and we can care what they do. Okay. Any more questions or coffee break? Coffee.